Well, thanks for being here today. I'm Chad Skipper. This is Elliot Lewis. We're here to tell you that the network, or can we say the corporate network, can no longer protect your data. So with that, we're going to walk you through the agenda real quick. I'm going to walk you through the data journey to get our minds right. And then we're going to look at some disruptors to that. Probably you've seen these things. Elliot's going to talk about the network alone can't protect your data. And then we're going to talk about some new data access risk models, some things that we have to really begin to look at as we begin to move down to where the data has to protect itself no matter its location. And then we'll drop into the data protection reference architecture that we're introducing here today. So let me say this again. The data needs to protect itself, right? We've got to get to that point. Starting in 1944, going from left to right, we had our mainframes. 1968, we had our workstations. 1978, we came up with transistors. Then, in early 1990s, we began to see this convergence of the internet, right? And now, today, risk is everywhere. Everything is connected. And it's your employees that now have this ravenous requirement, right, to be always connected to data. Right? So that's where risk is everywhere, and we're driving down to protection, down to the data itself. And that's where we need to be. So some of the disruptors that we're seeing out there is your employees, 85% of them today are using cloud tools of some sort. There's going to be 35 zettabytes on the cloud or in the cloud by 2020. And then mobility, here's another concern. Mobility is growing 5x. If it hasn't happened to you already, pretty soon, the majority of your devices within your corporate network are going to be employee-owned. So how do you deal with that when it comes to your data? And then 79% of us have actually said, yes, we've been breached. But I can tell you it's been 100%. We've all been breached. Some of us just don't know it. So as we move forward, let me talk about two kinds of protection that we're going to be using an analogy with today. I spent 4 years in the military, loved every bit of it, but I can tell you from a military perspective, we've got to start looking at this for the data itself. The headquarters being right where the soldier can roam around, he has a perimeter defense. The headquarters is your corporate network. The soldier is that data, right? Inside the headquarters, he can roam. I can go to the commissary, I can go to bed, I can go to work. All I have is identity. But it's when that soldier leaves the headquarters that that soldier now has body armor. He has weaponry. He has the ability to communicate back to the headquarters and ask how to engage. And so that's what we need to do with our data. When the data leaves your corporate network out in the field, we have to get to a point where we can arm that data with the intelligence that it needs to begin to protect itself no matter its residence.
So let's take a look at how that analogy expands. We all know how we have all the mitigations out there to allow us to firewall, IDS, IPS, encryption, AV, AM, all the things that we classically think about protecting our data. And when you look at the headquarters concept, what does this equate to? Our corporate data center, things that are controlled through via the DMZ, through the corporate managed clients that you hand out, control, do imaging on, do mitigations on. But that's not how it works anymore. We all know this because in every given day of our work, any one of us, we'll have a laptop, we download a file, we take that file and that laptop, we walk out the front door. Firewall hasn't seen it, the IDS, IPS systems may not have caught it, the DLP systems may not have caught it, and it's on some sort of endpoint device. And now it's out in the field, it's out in the wild. It could be interacting with BYOD devices, it could be acting with software as a service cloud infrastructure. We could be dealing with trusted entities that we have in our supply chain, but we don't control their security posture. And once we hand data over to them, that data is completely on its own. So when we talk about the analogy of that soldier going out into the field, how do we take data, give it the body armor, give it the weaponry, and most importantly, give it the communications capability to call back home and tell its owner, here's the situation I'm in. What do you want me to do, right? So we're going to look through how to make this happen. And the way you start off with this is you look at, first of all, data risk models. And we're going to concentrate on two very data risk models, starting out with data access control. What is data access control, and how do we look at inherent risk and mitigation control and how strong it is over the course of these risk models? In the most secure method that we can do today, We take a corporate laptop. We may take a corporate image on that laptop. We have the ability to apply all kinds of control sets, monitoring sets, everything to it on something we control in our own corporate network. This way, we have all the mitigations at play we put into place to protect this data. That is headquarters. But as we move into more and more risky areas, let's say we move out of the corporate headquarter network and go to Starbucks. Let's say we now put it onto a personal device, and that personal device has may or may not have a container on it, may or may not have corporate controls on it. It may or may not be touching a VPN. As we have these parameters and heuristics change over time, now we have to worry about how risky is the profile of what the data is sitting on and how is it being accessed.
Yeah, and with this now being data everywhere, we have to introduce data location, right? So there's two forms, right? It's in your corporate network and everything else. So from this perspective, we're going from strongest to weakest. The data that's residing in your corporate network naturally probably has more security controls. But it's when that data transits to a location, it's going to inherit that final destination's risk profile. I move from corporate to internet storage, Dropbox, whatever it might be, I'm open in the clear, right? Data in use and data at rest is going to inherit the access type on the far left.
So now we have risk models. We can apply certain kind of situations to data risk and data level. But the question is, how do we let that data say where it lies in whatever risk model? How do we get the data to say, I'm on this kind of device, this kind of an operation, and I'm going to this location? What risk model am I going to inherit in the course of my operations? So we have a step-by-step process to do the evaluation of helping the data communicate and speak to us and then inherit whatever policies we want to apply to it. Now, the first piece of this process is contextual access assessment. First things first, we do an identity process. Every piece of data should have the ability to say, is the person trying to access me allowed to do so? If they're not, stop right now. If they have no access to this data, if they're not authorized to see it, you should not be decrypting, you should not be allowing yourself to be seen. The data should be able to get that kind of assessment done very quickly and cleanly. And then if you are authorized to see it, then we take a look at the next step. What am I being opened on? What is the situation? Am I on a corporate asset? Do I sit on a corporate image? Are these corporate monitored situations? Or am I on a BYOD device? If I am, does this thing have corporate controls on it? Does it have a container? Does it have VPN? Do I have the ability to have an app stream capability? What am I talking about for an endpoint capability? And then the third piece to this is, where am I? What's touching me? In the case of a laptop, I could be on a Wi-Fi or a wired network or a Bluetooth capability. BYOD devices like smartphones and tablets have five different antenna arrays. What is touching me at this time and how risky is that touch? By getting these three pieces together, we can then go on to the next stage because we've developed these heuristics. The next stage is the ability to take a look at a little bit more in depth. Now that we have the basic heuristics of who, what, where, and how, we could then take a look at data classification capabilities and say, what is the level of risk that this data itself represents? Am I talking about a sensitive piece of data? And if I am, depending on where I'm at, if I'm off corp network, if I'm not on a managed device, if I'm not on a managed container, I can then take the next step and say, I want to verify identity again. Because anybody can possibly lose their username and password. If it's sensitive data in a risky situation, let's get a second factor involved. However that may be, no matter where I'm at, let's allow it to do a second factor of verification. Which then leads into, we can now select which policies apply. This is this piece of data being accessed by this person in this kind of scenario, in this kind of location. I could have multiple policies that apply to this situation, which means that to do this effectively and quickly and cleanly, we need to have two different pieces involved here. One, what is the policies that apply to me? Then, what is the resultant set of policies if I have two policies that apply that both allow access? Which one is the more restrictive? How do I get a result out of both of these to get one decision on how to see this data? And three, the policy conflict resolution tool sets. Because if I have two policies, one says no, one says yes, should it be immediately no? Or should we give the person access to the data another way? As an example, let's say the data is sitting on a personal device and it's encrypted. What if I could leave it encrypted on the device, but because the person's authorized to see this data, I leave it encrypted locally, then open up an app stream, let them see a copy of the data back in the data center in a secure way? We didn't have to say no. We just gave them a more secure method, and the data stayed safe in its risky environment.
So based on what Elliot just said, we now have the capability of arming the data with knowledge, right? And just like a soldier has rules of engagement, now our data now has rules of enforcement. So based upon the contextual analysis that we just talked about, the identity, the classification, the data now knows this. So the data knows that I'm on a managed laptop inside of a managed network, therefore I am going to allow this person to actually go off and take a look at this data behind the firewall. But do you have one of these? And does this have AVAM on it? Or when it comes to network segmentation, you might want to only allow access to data if he's part of a federated zone, a HIPAA zone, right, or PCI zone. So now the data is relevant, it knows that, and can be able to enforce that. Same thing with sandboxing. Can it only see the data in the sandbox application? Or if I have a BYOX device, does it have a container? Right? Don't open it up directly, but open it up on a container. And if I don't have that container, then give access via a secure browser back to the data center. Look, we're not saying no. We want to say yes, you can access data in this given context with this given enforcement arrays. And then finally, there's the encryption, right? We all know about encryption, but what about that key management? What keys are you going to use? Where are you going to obtain those keys? And it will come down to platform assessment. We now can give the encryption capability that much more information about the device. Example, does this device have a TPM? If it doesn't, don't put the file down there. If it does, I'll allow you to look at that particular data with a TPM module, right? What's the encryption capability? Can I encrypt to a certain encryption state? And if I can't, don't allow the data to be opened. Same thing with decryption and encryption when it comes to encrypting behind a firewall, decrypting behind the firewall in a container or a virtual browser. And then if you can store the key securely, then do it. But if you can't, wipe it. And then always there's that process closure of getting rid of all the data if you need to be.
Now, there was a lot of complex stuff and a lot of different steps and pieces, which is why when we're looking at a data protection reference architecture methodology, you look at how to go through a specific set of steps, operations, heuristics, controls, policies, and decision points in one comprehensive fabric mode to allow us to go through these discrete steps and figure out what to do under any situation, under any control set. Now, what's the hidden value that also comes with this? Each step is applying intelligence. We hear a lot of stuff about people talking about reactive to proactive to predictive. But if we can take this down to a data level and we allow all the various pieces from infrastructure to platform to application and let the data find out which things are appropriate in any given moment and any given risk level, we can now allow that data and multiple copies of that data, no matter where it resides in the world, from protected in the data center to all the way out on a USB stick in a foreign country, where it should never have been. And with this process, what can we say? We can now say you should either stay encrypted, you can decrypt under these auspices, or you know what, you shouldn't have been on a USB stick in a foreign country. Destroy yourself immediately, never allowing access or to even remain there. Think about what that would do to change things. And all of this is part of intelligence. We get intelligence out of each step of this. We can apply it to heuristics, to mitigation efficacy. We can apply it to data control. We can apply it to regulatory compliance methodologies and monitoring and data integrity capabilities. So this data access methodology, this data protection reference architecture, allows us to give this kind of a process control. And when we look at it from a more heuristic point of view, we have the fabric we just described with all these different pieces and processes. But what makes it possible is the ability to take all kinds of information and bring it together in an unstructured, to a structured methodology to allow the different levels of infrastructure, endpoint, software, data controls, intelligence operations to feed into the fabric and allow us to use all this information to allow data to protect itself. The data tells any given person when they try to access it, these are the policies that apply to me. You don't get to see me under these auspices. Maybe you do under a different way. Maybe I get to destroy myself. But the data is now able to protect itself in the wild and in the data center in all states, no matter how many copies there are.
And based on the risk analysis fabric that you're seeing here, we're talking about a lot of enabling technologies coming together and being better connected in order to provide us the ability for the data to use this enabling technology to produce an access result on its own, no matter its location. So this ability, we give you three different examples down in the bottom here, and we talked about some of those. But again, managed laptop, the identity is an employee. Yes, he can have full access, but behind the firewall, right? And he can download that data. However, if the data understand that it's on a BYOD container, right, he can access that via the container if he is a customer or a contractor, for example, giving him read access. But it's only in that container, and it can be via the virtual private networking. And then finally, another one's unmanaged device. You have customers coming in all the time. How about they can only view that access via the virtual and via the data streaming? And to say this is about enabling all of these tools. Look, we have so many tools out there. We've got to enable these tools to provide that information down to the data so that when the data goes out into the field, like the soldier, it now can protect itself no matter its residence.
So when you look at the entire way we're envisioning the DPRA operations, the data protection reference architectures we're looking towards enabling, then you can see how we are not just focusing on one mitigation, one aspect, one control set. We can't guarantee that data is going to go on any given path. I cannot predict at any given moment that this Word file is going to go through the firewall. It's going to be encountering our DLP systems. I cannot tell you once it goes onto a drive out there or into a partner area or a partner network what can happen to it. All I can do is trust. What we're saying now is there is no reason to trust. We trust and verify and take action because we don't put our data, our soldiers, in danger without allowing it to protect itself, control itself, speak to home, take its orders, work with everything it has available to it, and make strategic decisions about how it's going to operate out in the wild. We hope you got some value out of this, and we appreciate your time. Thank you very much.
Thank you.